I joined editing out of passion for what I'm doing. Okay. That passion is something, if I take for granted, then it's not going to lead me to much. It's not going to sustain me. If I get down to doing the same projects, the same things over and over and over, then at certain point, I might end up getting frustrated, or I might end up becoming a little, kya bolte hain, lazy. Ki, okay, there are two people talking. Maybe a boy and a girl are talking. Maybe they're talking about love, or maybe they're having an argument. That same scene can happen in four different films or four different stories. But what is the relevance of it in a particular story, or B, or how freshly away can one approach such a sequence and put it together, being the primary approach, the way I look at it. So the way I choose films is, can I connect with the story? A, does it seem appealing to me? Now all stories are appealing. Then it becomes a factor of who's doing what with that story. Then it becomes a question of talking to the director, the creative team behind it, the DP, in a meeting. So that it becomes a one-to-one thing. I'm reading the script, I'm reading the story, I'm picturing it in a certain manner. Now when I'm sitting with the person who is actually going to be organizing the entire thing, who's going to be shooting the entire thing, I need to see whether we are on the same page. Now if I read a funny script, like Kalakandi is an extremely funny script, on paper, Jaane Tu, Jaane Na was a funny script on paper. I had to understand, hey, are we making a grand masti? Or are we making a film, not that I'm looking down on something like grand masti, but I'm like, are we making something which is going to give you that pause, ki, hey, I have made a happy comment, I have made a smart comment. And then pause. That pause is basically to put some effect or whatever it's for. Well, that's a way of doing things. I mean, I don't relate to it. So I need to understand whether the approach is that. Am I going into a space in which this is what the primary concern is? Ki ye kaise isko sabse zyada funny banaye? Ya kaise isko wo intimately funny banaye? Ki ek small char log baith ke baat kar rahe hain and make it as natural as possible and it be a funny conversation within that. So there are different ways of looking at the same thing. So A, it's a story, whether I relate to that story or not. B is the makers, whether we talk at the same level or not. And then see, the most important thing is, how much freedom am I going to get? It's primarily that which is the deal breaker. If I can work with a fantastic story, I can work with fantastic people, I can do all of that, get along well with them. But if it means that for 3-4 months I will just have to listen to them without it being a democratic process, I cannot do that. So it becomes a choice of not really choice. So it basically becomes about me gaining the trust. What am I building, bringing on board? Okay. So if I'm working with you, for example, I read your story, what you have written or what you are excited about and what you want to make. I come up with my set of ideas. Whether you might like 10% of them or you might like 80% of them. But the point is, I'm coming with a viewpoint which is something different from what you are looking at it. Or maybe we both come with the same viewpoint. So at a certain point, you are going to be reassured as a maker that, acha, ye banda is thinking along the same lines that I am. Then it's a question of actually getting down to doing it and gaining in confidence, basically. Then it's basically about two people gelling together. So it's also very important for me that I be given that freedom to interpret or to bring in a new idea and to make it convincing, to be given a chance to make it convincing. Agar wo ek hi set rahega ki, you know, no, this is the only way I'm looking at it, then it becomes damn boring. Then it's like, there's nothing evolving there. There's no improvisation. There's nothing. There is just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what's the fun in that? So these are my primary concerns, and most of the times I've been lucky. So in terms of the films that I have done, I doubt there are two films which are the same. It's just varied. It's just varied. The closest anything would be thematically to any two subjects or two films in that sense, but the interpretation of it is different. The common factor in all of this is me, because I'm the one who is helping put it all together. So there's a lot of me in each and every film that has gone into it. There's a lot of learning curve that I myself have had in that journey. it all depends on how well I get along with the director. It's basically just that. Yes, I have made couple of mistakes, small mistakes along the way. Yes, I won't name them, but I'm not so happy with what eventually came out. But that's okay. I mean, that's part and parcel of, I guess, anybody's professional life. That's even a part of life by itself. See, you cannot gain trust from the word go. It's like any kind of a healthy relationship, okay? The film is a baby. It's a director's baby. If you actually look at it, the director is the one who's got the vision and who wants to look at the entire subject in a certain manner, entire story in a certain manner, entire script in a certain manner. You need to win that person over. So that if you come up with something which is radically different, even for a narrative idea within the same script, he should be taken by that. Or he should at least consider that as an option. That cannot happen overnight. I recently did a film called Gurgaon. It came out recently. It started off as thematically as something. It was being shot in a certain manner. The director is a very close friend of mine. And while shooting also, we were in touch. Like, he would call me up in the night and whatever, whenever they were shooting. He like, Achha, listen, the last scene was like this. This scene is like this. Do you think we need to shoot this entire thing? And then I would check my copy of the script and I'll refer to something. I'll say, nee, ye must shoot karo, ye shoot karo. Or, no, he's basically using me as a bouncing ball. Whether he eventually goes and shoots that, what I'm suggesting or not, is a different matter altogether. But the point is, he is trusting me to have an idea, have an opinion about what he's thinking. And he's trusting me to come up with an idea or a solution that I can suggest, that he can then keep as an option. Whether he chooses or not, again, that's entirely his choice, his or her choice. So it was a very collaborative process in that sense. We kind of made a whole cut of the film according to the script on which it was shot. According to the way it was shot, which is also slightly deviated from the script by itself. We sat on it for a while. It got selected for the film bazaar last year or the year before that, I'm forgetting. The work in progress karke ek section hai film bazaar mein, so it got selected for that. In the meantime, we had, because of that couple of months break that we had taken from the post-production of the film, I went and I finished another film in Chennai, and I came back and I was booming with full of ideas, even while I was working on that film. So I wrote him a mail saying, listen, let's try and do something different. Let's try and, for lack of a better term, let's try and fuck around with the narrative. So that is what we were playing around with. I said, give me some time. Let me work on some ideas in a little more constructive manner so that I can communicate to you what I'm talking about. I wrote down an entire structure of the film with just screwed around with every single thing. And he was excited by the idea of looking at the same story in a completely new manner. That is what he got excited with. Okay. Then we both sat down and we started reshaping it. It went into a third zone eventually. But the point is, there was trust. That was not exactly the final film that he was aiming towards when he started making it. But that was the final film that he was comfortable taking it towards. So it's a journey. It's that trust is never it's never gained overnight. Like even with my film Kalakandi with Akshat, the first time that I met him, he had heard about me from other people. So what I really loved about him was like he gave me the script and he said, see, this is just a nutshell. I have a beginning, I have an end. In between, we can just play around with it, which is what he put it as, and which I loved. I said, this is fantastic. If someone is so confident about their own theme, what they have written themselves, that they are saying, huh, let's play around with it. I'm confident about what I have written. I'm confident about what I'm going to shoot. I'm confident about my story and the way my narrative is going to open up. they just play around and make it more interesting. If there is a much more interesting way of it being expressed than it, what it's being written on paper, then why not is the point of it. That's always a good sign for me per se. And that's always a good sign for anyone, I guess, who would be working with a confident director. It's not a question of ego. It is not that. It's a question of confidence in your material, in your own abilities, which is unique and which is nice about it. Yeah, there have been a couple of times that I've done films because I had to pay the rent and all of that. Of course, everybody does that. But those were also films which I strive to make interesting, but which were also interesting. So even if it was a commercial film, hardcore commercial film, I was lucky enough to meet with people who were making something slightly different even within that space. Like, for example, it was great working with Mr. Kamal Haasan on two films that I've worked with him. Everybody knows the kind of films he makes. Correct. So it is commercial, of course. But then he brings his own unique perspective to all the films that he does. And my interactions, my one-to-one interactions with him have been such a learning experience for me per se. As a filmmaker, as a HOD, as a film worker, whatever you might want to call it, as a film student. The way he approaches a scene is unique. Even when he himself is shooting, he's directing a film, Vishwaroopam, so I was lucky enough to be there for that. It's completely different. I have not seen that in anybody else that I've worked with. The subtle movements of the camera that he likes to put up. You know, this is old school in a way. This is old school in a way where they take time to take that perfect shot. And they're not worried about, okay, let's finish. We got three scenes to shoot in the next 4 days. Let's just shoot quick and move. No. He takes that time. But then, of course, he gets budget like that too. So that's a different matter. But the fact is he himself takes that effort to invest so much of himself and so much of his own energy into getting something which is great, and in terms of also getting something which would last, say, 10 seconds on screen and then we move on to the next shot. That investment is what is crucial, because that is what also eggs each and every one in that crew to do their best in that sense. So there has been a mixed bunch of even in films that I've worked with him, it's always been something slightly different that I managed to put in. Manamathan Anbu, we did that whole reverse song, which was primarily his idea, of course. Nobody's saying. But then he gave Manush, the DP, that freedom to interpret in a certain manner. He gave Shobi, the choreographer, that freedom to interpret in a different manner. He himself worked so hard to get the lip sync in, you know, correctly. And he just the only change he made was at the end of when he saw the edit, and he didn't do anything. He said, just put this one dissolve here. There was some sequence in which the girl jumps off the bed, or rather in reverse. And he just said, you know, just dissolve, put a dissolve here, it'll be smoother. That's the only thing he said. I remember a lot of times he would bring people to the edit room while I was working on that to show them a scene from the film. It was a work in progress. And he was very proud about that the film was shaping up so nicely. And he would be like, you know, he was extremely encouraging. That's one thing that I've seen of him. Is he would talk about all how the old timers used to sort a problem that they would face, and then how he would bridge that approach with the new technology that he has access to, that we all have access to. But the thought process is still like how one would do that. Like, I don't think it's far different from what a Christopher Nolan or someone approaches their theme from. So it's every single interaction, every single film that I've done has been a learning experience for me myself into whatever I am at this moment and whatever I choose to do in future at this moment. So I have been lucky enough to be able to bridge both, like a Harud on one side and the Tungavanam on the other. In film school, I was always interested in a varied kinds of cinema. Okay, I was not really hung up on one particular kind of films. Okay, to me, even as a child, I would love listening to different stories. I would love listening to mythological stories and all that my mother would tell me about. I would love listening to whatever stories that my cousins would tell me whenever they come from, say, their college life and everything. And they would talk about some stories they heard, something which is horror and something which is a simple story with a message or a twist in the end. I would love sitting with my father and watching TV, those Hindi films on TV. At that point of time, all of these kind of have built in me a thirst for different kinds of stories. Basically, it's also for me to enrich myself, and it's also something that I reflect back upon, because wo khali absorb karke, it's not going to amount to much if I don't reflect it back out. So, like I was saying, like primarily my connection is with the story, is with the theme of what it is, and the interest from me comes from understanding that, oh, this is an interesting way of looking at the same story, at the same theme. This is a very interesting way of looking at, say, a love story, or this is a way of looking at, say, jealousy as an angle, or deception, or whatever it might be, or thriller as a genre. So it's got to do with what is the unique way in which you're looking at it. Now, a joke can be told in five different ways. Five different people will say the same joke in five different ways. Okay. But out of that, only two would make sense and you would really laugh for the longest. And then the way one person, particular person says it, you will laugh for like 10 days just remembering that particular narration, so to say. So that is what is key. How to get closer and closer to that second and the first kind of a narrative, which the person who is experiencing that story from you would retain the most and would enjoy the most. So cinema is a format that lets anyone live out a dream. I mean, imagine a darkened hall and you have like 300, 500 people in that hall, just everybody looking in one direction. One square, a rectangular screen in which there are images flickering and everybody is sitting and looking in one direction. Imagine the kind of control and power that format is giving to you as a maker to manipulate. The better you are at manipulating that set of rules, the more you would engage your audience. So I'm coming to a theater to watch a film, maybe in a theater, or maybe I'm sitting and watching it on my laptop or whatever. I want to be told a story in a most interesting way, in a most interesting way for me to experience. Maybe it's funny, maybe it's sad, maybe it's romantic, maybe it's a thriller, whatever it be. I should take something back from it, or at least I as an audience should feel that, oh, that was nice, that was interesting, that's a nice way of looking at the same thing. Then I have connected to the audience. If the audience is not even going to relate to me at all in terms of whatever I'm saying, then that entire film goes haywire in that sense. So the editor actually is important, a crucial person in that thing to maintain the objectivity of that purpose. Is the way I look at it, which in turn means that the editor by himself should never lose objectivity while he's working on a project. That's also very crucial, like you're saying. So 8 hours of the first cut is 8 hours, which means there would be a whole lot of things in that cut, which would mean the script itself would have been even longer, because there were so many, it's based on a real book actually. So there would be a lot of other things that it's got reference to, that while shooting, the director thought, no, this is also interesting, this is also interesting, let me shoot this, because you never know what's going to be of use. Okay, so you end up shooting it, and it's always better to shoot. Like, I mean, I think anytime I speak to youngsters or whoever, even people that I who have made films and all, I always say my opinion is that if you think you want to shoot it, shoot it. Do not worry about how it's going to come in the film, at what point, kaise aayega, kaise usko rakhenge, lamba ho jayega. Do not worry about that. You think instinctively this is needed in your film, shoot it. the process of putting it together will tell you whether you eventually require that or not. Don't at that point feel, shucks, I should have a shortcut. Then you're in trouble. Provided you have a limited budget, or you know, you have to finish your film within a certain time period or whatever it might be. If you have shooting with n number of unlimited budgets and all that, then there's nothing. You can always go back and reshoot. So working with different people on different approaches has been different for me in that sense. So working with Kamal Haasan, for example, it's been, I mean, he has access to everything that he can do. If he wants to reshoot the entire scene, he can pretty well go and reshoot the entire thing. But there was also a discipline in that. That the first time that he approached it, that no, this is the way it needs to be done in a good way. So just because you have an option to go and redo it does not mean that you slack off the first time around. Whereas the other side is youngsters who come in with a fixed amount of budget, like say Abbas or say Akshat or Ayan or anyone basically. So they have certain boundaries that they cannot go over. So they need to improvise within that. So when I was working with Abbas, actually it was his first film. It was my almost first, but it was like my second film, but it was almost my first film any which ways. So it was wonderful to just start working on stuff, on the set of rushes that he had shot, and to start putting them together and to start seeing a different shape to the film. We took, I think it's there in the deleted scene or something, it's been ages since I remember. There was this whole interaction between the boy and girl, which was setting up, you know, what kind of a relationship they have. And then we decided at the end, you know, you don't need this. We are playing with a certain cliche of sorts, that two friends who don't know they're in love, but they are friends, they are very good friends. Let's work with that as an assumption. If you work with that as an assumption, you don't need to put 3-4 scenes which are showing you the same thing, which the beginning of the scene says that they were good friends. They were this set of friends who are traveling and who are talking about these two people that they're going to pick up from the airport. So you end up bridging that. So the choice then becomes, yeah, we have already given this information. This information is clean enough. You don't need this because there's nothing new that is coming out of it. It could be entertaining, yes, but there's nothing new. And then you can jump straight to a different part of the story, which would be a little more interesting, that being the point of it. So editing choices, I think, primarily come or originate out of a sense of objectivity, which is primary. One can always get lost. I mean, if you are looking too narrowly at something, then you will not see the bigger picture. So for me, my first card, which I fight for, which I said, let me interpret it. I could go wrong also. That's not a problem because I can rectify it. The first card is always about putting things together and then stepping back and looking at it. Let it be everything. Everything that is shot, put it in. The first card is almost always the most horrible thing on this planet. Almost always. There are very few things which are great about the first card. I don't think in my working years I've seen much good things out of a first cut. But that tells you what are the potentials of the cut. What are the drawbacks? What are the weak points of it? What you need to rework and what you need to start worrying about now? How do I make sure this gets communicated? And then you can always look at that story arc. So the first cut, which is your script, whatever has been shot, would then lead to you reassessing the narrative. Now, this is the way I work it. Many other people would work in a different way. So I look at it and I start thinking. Immediately, my gears start moving inside my head like, okay, now this is fine, this is fine. Then this scene makes sense. Does this scene contribute anything to this? Can we jump from the middle of this one scene to the fourth scene, middle of that fourth scene? It would be an interesting connection, which could be an oral connection, which is an audio connection, or maybe it could be just a visual. Somebody's opening a door and somebody's closing a door there. Or someone moves halfway across the scene and you jump to another place and someone is moving on the other side. Whatever it might be. But these are all connections which are being imposed. Okay, somebody sitting there and doing that. That's an idea that has originated from somewhere. And then you take it further and further and further. So the point of this whole exercise is to not have anything loose in your narrative, which would cause an audience to space out, so to say. But then that also is a drawback. Are you making it too logical? Are you making it too point to point? Are you missing the point of telling a story? A story, the best stories that you remember are not ones that go straight from setting it up and going to a conclusion. It's about experiencing that whole journey of the story. So then that's also a thing that you need to worry about, that, you know, hey, am I making it too cut to cut? That's the way it's termed, which is basically you make one point, then you jump to making another point, then you jump to making a third point. So these are the choices that one has to go through. Now, all of these choices are different each time you work on something, and it differs from scene to scene. There is zero commonality between what happens. Maybe the same scene was taken from a different film, but in here it's got a different context. So what do you do? How do you approach this? So it's also got to do with a lot of experience that you have. I've been lucky enough to meet people so early in life who gave me the freedom to interpret things, and also who were there to point out, like, you know, okay, you're thinking in this way, but then this could be an issue. So that became a learning experience for me. For me to work on something, step back and look at it and say, maybe I can do better. Not better in terms of maybe two frames here, two frames there. No, I'm not talking about that. That comes pretty late in the way I do things. But better in how I interpret that scene, how I have put together that scene. Better in, is the emotional point of that particular scene coming across. So, how is it helping the overall, how, at what point is it coming in the overall graph of your story? Okay. And what is the motivation of this particular character or this particular character or the number of people who are significant in that particular scene? Can I make it better? Can I make it more clearer, being the point of it? And better is a relative term in that sense. It can only come from experience. I mean, I take workshops in FTI and I see students who are eager to learn, and I see them making the same mistakes that I used to make when I was a student. And now I can step back and I can see, and I've been, basically my thing is not to go there with answers. My approach is to go there with more questions for them. Are you sure you should be looking at it like this? What do you think? It's basically questioning them rather than giving them answers. Ki haan, isko yahan se idhar kar do. That's the solution to your problems. So there have been certain exercises that I have struggled with when I was a student there, which thankfully, till date, I find students struggling with the same exercises even now. Like early this year, I had gone to the institute and I said, you know, pull that exercise and start working on that. And each and every one of them failed in that exercise. You do that. But then that is the beauty of that scene, that the way it's from a film, Maniratnam's film, and Shrikar Prasad has put it together. There is so much subtext in that. You will only understand that once you have had some kind of an experience. There is so much playing around with just the grammar of the language of cinema that it's just unbelievable what that scene these guys have done. You cannot know that unless and until you see the rushes and you struggle with it to put it together, to come even 10% close to what eventually is there in the scene, in the film. So, in terms of a contribution of an editor, it's not really visible. It's like, okay, this is something, it's a little cliched, it's a little cheesy also in a way. But if a non-film guy asks me, you know, so what do you do kind of a thing, and this is what I say. Like, you know, you make dal, okay, everything is there in that dal, but do you have ample salt in it? If it's not there, you will feel it. You will say, ki, are yaar, isme salt nahi hai, namak kam ho gaya lag raha, thoda sa namak de do mujhe. If it's there, if it's perfect, you eat it. You don't think, haan, wo to namak dala hai, correct proportion mein chef ne dala hoga. You don't think of all of that. It's the same thing here. In general terms, the contribution of an editor cannot be visible. So I don't really, frankly, I don't really understand when somebody gives, like, okay, it's a best editor award and stuff. I don't understand it. Have you seen the rushes? So how do you judge that it's a good edit? You have not seen the rushes. So how do you know? If you have seen the rushes and then you're judging it, then it's fantastic. Then yes, of course. But generally, it does not happen like that. It's if it's a film is successful, then, you know, all the success, all the adulations and everything goes to that by default. So that's how it is. Maybe the small film that was released early in the year, which was barely possible, maybe it was made barely possible out of general, like B. Lenin says, garbage. 20 hours, 50 hours of garbage. A film was made which was decent, let me put it that way, than the best film which was made with the top star and which was okay at the least. So it's all depends on different people, whoever have contributed, not necessarily just the editor. It's a teamwork in that sense. So in a post-production, what happens inside that room stays between the editor and the director. Because there's no one else in that room during the struggle to create what you want to create. People only come in towards the end of it and say, "Haan, ye 8 minute lamba ho gaya, ya thoda sa lamba laga, ya, you know, no, it's not coming out, maybe that performance is bad." They all come with their interpretations of things, with the idea that maybe that is what the problem is, but that's not always true. So how you get feedback also is very important when you're putting something together. That feedback, how you assimilate that feedback is also very important. So hence, coming back to the point of objectivity. So at a certain point, if you're involved with a project over a long period of time, you are certain to lose objectivity. It's up to you to step back at that point when you realize it. If you can afford that time, step back from it. Take a little time off. Even if it's for 2 days, 3 days. Then come back to it. With completely, you know, pretend as if you're seeing the rushes for the first time. Pretend as if you're seeing this film for the first time. Look for flaws. Look for flaws. And then try and make them better. It's a complex process. For me at least, it's never in a straight line. It's never a straight line. And I'm editing, for me, helps me in reinterpreting stories, not just putting it together. I don't want to put anything together. There are n number of people who are willing to do that. Good luck to them. So every single film that I have done, or web series, or anything else that I have done, there is a bit of me in that, that I am proud of, that I can point out and say, yes, see, that idea actually came because I experienced this when I was in college, or, you know, or maybe I was walking down the road in Bombay and I experienced that. So that idea, I connected from that, and I tried to make that clear here, given that I understood this is a scenario in which that can be brought in. That's primarily it.